that when Krishna comes, people consider him as an ordinary person. So now we'll go further in the discussion as to what is the spiritual world all about. So we'll continue with that. Okay, let's read now. In the effulgent rays of the spiritual sky, you are in that group, Gita class as it is. You can help him out in my phone. In the effulgent rays of the spiritual sky, there are innumerable planets floating. The Brahma Jyoti emanates from the supreme abode, Krishna Lok, and the Anandamaya Chinmay planets, which are not material, float in those rays. The Lord says, Na tad bhasayate suryo na shanku na pavakah, yad gatva na nivartante tad dhama parma mama. One who can approach that spiritual sky is not required to descend again to the material sky. In the material sky, even if we approach the highest planet of Brahmaloka, what to speak of the moon, we will find the same conditions of life, namely birth, death, old disease and old age. No planet in the material universe is free from these four principles of material existence. A small point that Krishna, you know that in Krishna's highest abode is Golok Vrindavan, and then there are so many Vaikuntha planets. Just like in this sky, there's a blue sky, or can say whole sky is there. There are various planets are there. One thing which Prabhupada is very nicely mentioning is that even up to Brahmaloka, there are these four problems. But we have to also clarify on this regard that in Brahmaloka or even in Swargaloka, there is no old age. So exactly speaking, birth, death, disease and old age are only in Martya, in this loka. But then as we go to Swargaloka and higher, there is no old age. But there is death. There is birth and death, there is death. And birth is also not like the way we take birth here. It's not, the birth here is very painful. So in Swargaloka and other places, it's not painful. But the pain is that they know that when their garland, especially in Swargaloka, when their garland is withering away, then it's their time for dying. Then they become very morose. Like this. And you see that kind of death is very painful because the enjoyment you're getting is very, very, very high. But so knowing that enjoyment will be taken away from that person, he will be very, very morose. The same thing in Brahmaloka, practically there is no unhappiness, but there is unhappiness or there is a fear of death in the sense that they know after Dviprardha, that means after the whole life of Brahmaji, it will all be destroyed. And it may appear very long for us, but it's just like a spark in the whole time. In time eternity, the whole life of Brahmaji is like a spark only. Lord Vishnu takes inhalation and an exhalation, that is the whole lifetime of Brahma. That's a very good point to meditate upon. Sometimes people think, all of you might think, those who are in homes, if I don't get married, what will society think? As if we are very important in this world. And you see how what Brahmaji is saying. Many times people think, oh, I have such a long life. How can I live? How can I give it to Krishna? I have so many things to do, very important. So if you have that meditation, that what is the significance of life of Brahmaji, then we understand how much insignificant our life is. So anyhow, the point is, none of these places are meant to be fixed places. One thing I want to share in Shastric inspiration, yes. In Srimad Bhagavatam 6.3.32, Prabhupada says, thus, there is no use in endeavoring to travel up and down in the universe, going to Brahmaloka and coming down. It is better to chant the holy name of the Lord so that one may become fully purified and eligible to return home back to Godhead. That is the aim of life and that is the perfection of life. Beautiful point, Prabhupada says. There is no point because anywhere in this material world, I'm not going to be happy because everything is material. Even if you go to Swarga, you won't be happy because there is no transcendental happiness you're going to get. That's why Prabhupada is saying that best is to chant Hare Krishna and go back to Godhead. Now, how does chanting Hare Krishna help us to go back to Godhead? It's very simple. It purifies you of all material desires. All the vasanas are given up. And then we have no other desire except to serve the Lord. It's very simple and scientific. And then you go back to Godhead. If you have a desire, if you only have a desire to serve Krishna, then very easy. Then you only think of Krishna. See, at the time of death, we will think of something else only if we have attachment to that object. Our mind goes to that object on which our mind is attached to. It's very simple. So Hare Krishna, or in the process of bhakti, it removes those attachments. So your attachment is going again and again to Krishna. It's a very scientific process, but it has to be done diligently all our life. Then we can actually think of Krishna. Okay, move ahead. The living entities are traveling from one planet to another, but it is not that we can go to any planet we like merely by a mechanical arrangement. If we desire to go to other planets, there is a process for going there. This is also mentioned, Yanti Devavrata Devan Pitran Yanti Pitravataha. No mechanical arrangement is necessary if we want interplanetary travel. The Gita instructs, Yanti Devavrata Devan. The moon, the sun, and higher planets are called Swargaloka. These are three different status. There are three different statuses of planets, higher, middle, and lower planetary systems. The earth belongs to the middle planetary system. Bhagavad Gita informs us how to travel to the higher planetary system, Devaloka, with a very simple formula, Yanti Devavrata Devan. One need only worship the particular demigod of that particular planet, and in that way go to the moon, the sun, or any of the higher planetary systems. Yet, Bhagavad Gita does not advise us to go to any of the planets in this material world, because even if we go to Brahmaloka, the highest planet, though some sort of mechanical contrivance means arrangement, by maybe traveling for 40,000 years, and who will live that long, we will still find the material inconveniences of birth, death, disease, and old age. Very nicely explained by Vrindavan Chandra Maharaj. It is heard in this lok, or in this earth planet, that if you kill a snake, the snake tends to run after you. Similarly, no matter on which planet we go in this material world, the kala sarpa, that means the snake, the snake in the form of time is after everybody. Everyone is dying here, no matter how long they are living. It's like being in the mouth of an anaconda or a python, and slowly he's taking us inside, isn't it? So only a person who is engaged in Krishna's devotional service, he becomes free from this Kal Sarpa. So everybody is actually in effect affected by Kal Sarpa Dosh. Have you heard this Kal Sarpa Dosh? Everybody has this fault because everybody is being slowly eaten by this Kal Sarpa. Except a person who utilizes his time in discussing about Krishna. Ayur Harati Vaipumsam. You have know that shloka like this. But one who, and another point, very nicely, just because I may have an airplane, can I go to America? If I ask you, what is the qualification to go to America? So it's not that simply by having an airplane that you will be allowed to enter into America. You need to have visa, you need to have qualification. Yes. Similarly, just by having a plane, so if that facility it can be done by America or by any other country for that matter, so now if you're going to other planetary systems, how can you say just by having a space shuttle, you can go to the planet? So you need to have that qualification. That qualification is Yanti Devavrata Devan. When a person actually worships a demigod, then by the Lord's arrangement, he takes birth in that demigod's planet. But one who wants to approach the supreme planet Krishna Loka or any of the other planets within the spiritual sky will not meet with these material inconveniences. What are the material inconveniences? Birth, death, disease, and old age. Amongst all of the planets in the spiritual sky, there is one supreme planet called Goloka Vrindavan, which is the original planet in the abode of the original personality of Godhead, Shri Krishna. Original word, you understand? In the word original, there is a word called origin. Original, and in that the word is origin. That means Adi, root. Just like Krishna is the root of all the Vishnu expansion, similarly Golok is considered like a root. From there, all the Vaikuntha planets are expanding like that. All of this information is given in Bhagavad Gita, and we are given through its instructive information how to leave the material world and begin a truly blissful life in the spiritual sky. This is a beautiful statement by Srila Prabhupada. You see, Prabhupada not only gives philosophy, but he gives his deep realizations. So we are so much absorbed in this material life, isn't it? Thinking as if this is our only life and there is nothing afterwards. And thinking that now we are somehow not happy by some arrangement will be happy. But it's never going to happen. In this material world, we'll always be miserable. We will always be suffering. Even for devotees, they will be suffering. Because this is a place of suffering. But a devotee understands and he does not plan to return to this world. I'll repeat these words. A devotee does not plan to come back to this world. He does not want to come back to this world. Please make sure if you understand this clearly. He does not want to be in this world. If Krishna wants him to be in this world, then he has no objection. But he does not want to be in this world. Samajh mein aa raha hai? If I want to be in this world, means I am attached to the enjoyment being provided in this world. But if Krishna wants me to be in this world for some service, that's a different thing. Even if it's an austerity, a devotee may accept it to please Krishna. Make sense? In the 15th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, the real picture of the material world is given. It is said there, Urdhvamulamadha shakham ashvattham prahuravyam chandans yasaparnani yastam vedasa vedavit. We have discussed in the Hindi classes. Here the material world is described as a tree whose roots are upwards and branches are below. We have experience of a tree whose roots are upward. If one stands on the bank of a river or any reservoir of water, he can see that the trees reflected in the water are upside down. The branches go downward and the roots upward. Similarly, this material world is a reflection of the spiritual world. The material world is but a shadow of reality. In the shadow, there is no reality or substantiality. But from the shadow, we can understand that they are substance and reality. Beautiful, amazing purport of Srila Prabhupada. First thing, the tree is there and the reflection is there in the water. Reflection has to be there in the water or the mirror. So mirror is not suitable for tree, we can say water. So that water is our desire to enjoy. You have seen, you must have heard, Prabhupada explains it, that in the desire for enjoyment, this whole material world becomes reflected. In the sense, because I have a desire to enjoy, that's why I see everything as for my enjoyment. I think I myself is the center of this world. But rather, when I have love of God, even in this world, I can see everything in connection with Krishna, and I'll see everything. I think I will see myself situated in spiritual reality, spiritual world, because everything is for Krishna's enjoyment. Does it make sense? It's a very subtle point, has to be understood. If there is no desire for enjoyment, you are in spiritual world. And if I desire for enjoyment, then I'm in material world. Because the material world also is a spiritual world. And does it make sense? It is also part of kingdom of God only. It is not outside kingdom of God. But because we have that consciousness of enjoyment, that's why we are suffering. Pure devotees don't suffer. Do they suffer? Like one time, one devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, after Tulsi Devi leaves the body, where does she go? Does she go to spiritual world? The Prabhupada says, she's always in a spiritual world. She's always in a spiritual world. You are where your consciousness is. So the pure devotee's consciousness is always in the spiritual world. Vishwam Purna Sukhayate, he does not experience miseries in this material world. Makes sense to you? It is something very amazing. Now, second point which Prabhupada explained very nicely here is, it is a shadow. Now you can see, if there is prasadam, whole full plate of prasadam, but if the image is sent to you in WhatsApp, so it's only a shadow or not? You may feel very happy looking at that food, but your hunger is not going to get satisfied. If we can somehow other imbibe it in our life, we can so much transform ourselves. Think very deeply. We are trying to enjoy in various ways by material means or not. And what is the hope? That by these enjoyments, I can somehow there be happy. Just like it is same as by thinking, by looking at the pictures of various foods, I'll become satiated in my hunger. And that's why people in this world, even if they are not devotees, they are frustrated. Not even if I say, because they are not devotees, and they may enjoy in any way possible, they will always be unsatisfied, because all those enjoyments do not touch the soul, just like my tongue cannot touch the photo, or it may touch the photo of the bhoga or prasadam or food, but the food cannot touch my tongue. Samajh rahe na, shadow, you understand shadow of the point. By shadow you cannot be happy. It's a very important point. That is, should be a devotee's clear cut understanding of the material world. That no matter how I want to enjoy in material life, I can never be happy. I can only be happy by serving Krishna and by having pure love for the Lord. Okay? But another example Prabhupada is giving, by the shadow, in the photo there is food, there is no food. But food must be somewhere whose photo has been sent to you by WhatsApp. Do you agree? Without a substantial food, a photo cannot be given. A shadow cannot be there. Similarly, in this world there is no happiness, but there is happiness in the spiritual world of the shadow of which this material world is. Okay? In the desert there is no water, but the mirage suggests that there is such a thing as water. Clear? You are seeing a mirage. There is an appearance of water. Is there any water there? No. And I am seeing water because of my illusioned vision. There is no water. And second thing is that as soon as I approach, it goes away. It further goes away. Yes, know this example. And in that whole process, I am becoming more and more thirsty, and then I die finally. Similarly, in trying to run after material enjoyments, I only become more and more frustrated. That's why so many people commit suicide, even if they are materially happy. Isn't it? Yes. Okay. Now, where is that? The Lord, no, in the material world there is no water, there is no happiness, but the real water of actual happiness is there in the spiritual world. So one should try to, by hearing this, one should try to go to the spiritual world. The Lord suggests that we attain the spiritual world in the following manner. Nirmana moha jita sanga dosha adhyatma nitya vinavitta kamaha dvandair vimuktaha sukha dukha sangair gachantya mooda padama vayam tat. We will explain this shloka when we read by Krishna's arrangement. If you can read 15th chapter, then we will explain it in detail. But right now we just read Prabhupada's purport. That padam avyam or eternal kingdom can be reached by one who is nirmana moha. What does this mean? We are after designation. Sometimes someone wants to become sir, someone wants to become lord, someone wants to become the president or a rich man or a king or something else. As long as we are attached to these designations, we are attached to the body, because designations belong to the body. But we are not these bodies, and realizing this is the first stage in spiritual realization. So nirmana moha means illusion. Illusion means not able to understand things as they are. So I am not this body, but I am thinking that I am this body. And then I become attached to the designation. He is BTech, he is MTech, he is PhD, permanent head damage, and so many things, isn't it? I am a doctor, I am an MBBS and MBD. All those things are only a designation, a labeling. Designation means label. He's a manager, he's a this and that. So that being attached to this label, we become intoxicated, and then we do not understand who we are. One nice example, one devotee was mentioning that as we leave our slippers outside the temple, before we enter the temple, similarly we should leave our designations when we come in the association of devotees. I'm not a manager, I'm not anybody. I'm just simply a servant of Krishna, and other devotees are also servants of Krishna. Very nice example, no? Give up the slippers outside, then we can enter into temple. We are associated with the three modes of material nature, but we must become detached through devotional service to the Lord. If we are not attached to devotional service to the Lord, then we cannot become detached from the modes of material nature. What is that? As soon as a person renders service to Krishna, he is out of the modes of material nature. But as soon as he is detached from Krishna's service, again he is within the three modes of material nature: Satagun, Rajagun, or Tamagun. Am I going too fast, or is it understandable? Designations and attachments are due to our lust and desire, are wanting to lord it over the material nature. Designations means upadhi. Attachments means आसक्ति अटैचमेंट एंड दिस बिकॉज वी वॉन्ट टू एंजॉय दिस मटीरियल एनर्जी. As long as we do not give up this propensity of lording it over material nature, there is no possibility of returning to the kingdom of the Supreme, the Sanatan Dharma, Dhamma. So did you understand this point? I mentioned by chanting Hare Krishna, by reading Bhagavad Gita, by taking to the process of bhakti, this desire to enjoy, this is called Asat Trishna. Asat means which is matter. Trishna means desire. The desire to enjoy matter is slowly diminished by the process of devotional service. Try to understand, because I do not become satisfied to enjoy matter in a certain way, then I say, I was not happy to enjoy fully in this life. Maybe if I would have been a little bit taller, maybe I would have been a little bit fair skinned, I would have been happy. Are you able to understand this point? And that maybe will lead us to next birth. Does it make sense? That is what being mentioned here. The desire for enjoyment is there. Then again, we get another body. That eternal kingdom, and then as we practice Krishna consciousness, we simply realize, I will accept things which are needed for the maintenance of this body. I am not this body. And so that I can execute Krishna consciousness. Devotees also take care of their health, but not with the understanding that they are this body. Rather, it's a bad bargain. I'm not supposed to have this body, but since I'm in this body, because of my previous activities, so I must do take care of the body so that I can execute Krishna consciousness through this body, so that my desires will get finished or cleared of material desires. Since that eternal kingdom which is never destroyed can be approached by one who is not bewildered by the attractions of false material enjoyments, who is situated in the service of the Supreme Lord. Samajhmai? See, a person can go back to Godhead when he can understand how this world is illusory. Yesterday, some devotee asked in the Hindi class that relatives are asking him to eat bhoga. Just reflect, if you die tomorrow, the same relative will say, this person has died, and because of which our home has become contaminated for 13 days. Same people. And they will not know where you have gone. So one should be responsible to look at the time, as Prabhupada is saying. Yes, we should look at the time and see, I have less time left. My death is coming, approaching. Yes, we should be conscious. We should look at what is time. So much time has left. So much time has finished. That's a fact. And you see, because we become free from time when we discuss Krishna Katha, that's why the clock seems to go very slow. Isn't it? If we are discussing material things, we never look at the time. I can understand. Don't worry, we'll finish in 5 minutes. This class will be not very long. So, okay. Before going forward, I'll ask you, what is your takeaway point from today's discussion? Huh? I'll ask you this. Every day when we are going to have this class, I will ask you, what did you learn? Something, one point you learned from this discussion that we're having. Once so situated, can easily approach that Supreme Lord. Means, once a person is situated in this consciousness, this world is illusory. I do not belong to this place. I must go back to Krishna, then he can go back to Krishna. It's a very simple point. And if a person is identifying himself as an enjoyer of this world, it would be difficult for him to go back to spiritual world. He won't desire also. So I'll stop here and I'll take some questions or something which you have learned from this shloka or whatever discussion has happened. Instead of going very long, I just wanted to make it small and some point which you learned from the discussion, something you remember, you can speak, Prabhu. And other devotees are on Zoom also can mention. I'll give them opportunity. Yes.
In this material world, we are thinking this object, we are sense gratification.
Yes.
Taking, but this is our desire. So
speak in the mic, clear.
This is our desire. So that's why we are attached to that sense gratification.
Yes.
So when we start to stop that desire, we connected to Krishna is eternal. So Krishna, we can serve the Krishna, so eternal. So when Krishna will take to back to Godhead.
Okay, so the point which Prabhu has said that because of being attached to material objects, we have material desires to enjoy, and that's we are taking birth again and again. So once we start serving Krishna, those desires vanish, and our only desires is to serve Krishna. Then we go back to Godhead. Anything else? Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, just like this material world is the...
You speak in the mic and switch on the mic. Yes.
Reflection of the...
Yes, the one point we have learned is that material world is a reflection of the spiritual world, and just like we cannot be satisfied with the reflection, we have to have the actual thing. Similarly, we cannot be happy by material enjoyment. Yes. Prince Prabhu, Prem Krishna Prabhu, you want to say something?
I have learned a very nice point from this lecture that you said that whenever we enter in the temple, we put
up. Yes, just like we enter the temple, we give up our shoes. Similarly, when we come to bhakti, when we start chanting of Bhagavad Bhakti, we should give up these designations. We should not be proud. I'm a manager or I'm anybody. I'm a simple servant of Krishna. Okay, any questions from the devotees? Okay. No. So we shall stop here. Continue our discussion from tomorrow. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.